CNN.
He was America's mayor after 9/11, then a presidential candidate. Now Rudy Giuliani is a lightning rod, even within his own party, for saying that the president does not love America. He first made the comments at a private event, but then he went on TV to double down.
I don't feel this love of America. His initial approach is to criticize this country and then afterwards to say a few nice things about us.
In an interview with CNN's Jim Acosta, Giuliani said, quote, "I don't regret making that statement. I believe it." The Republican Party's presidential candidates were left holding the bag. This is supposed to be the new GOP, the party that cares about these things.
The stickiness of poverty is a huge challenge for this country.
If we can get immigration right, we got a good chance of winning in 2016.
When you have great economic success, you need to share it with those who live in the shadows.
Evolve, adapt, or die. I think the party has to change.
But this week, that party was blindsided by one of its most elite members. And joining me now to talk about all this and the future of the party is quite an elite group. Tom Ridge, former Pennsylvania governor and an advisor to Jeb Bush. George Pataki, who was governor of New York on 9/11. He's thinking about a presidential run. And Congressman Darrell Issa, a leading member of the House Republican Conservative Caucus. Thanks so much to all of you for being here with me. I'm going to go first to Governor Pataki, because you were Rudy Giuliani's post-9/11 partner there in the state of New York. When you were governor, he was mayor. What did you think when you heard him utter those words that the president doesn't love America?
Well, Gloria, let me first say I was honored to work with Rudy. We worked as closely as two leaders could at that time, and I'm proud of how well we came together and the American people came together after September 11th to get us through that horrible time. But, Gloria, just think. You just had the Homeland Security Secretary saying Americans have to use extreme caution if we go to the Mall of America in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Now, and we're talking about this? We should be talking about a proactive strategy to go after Islamic terrorists overseas, what we have to do to grow our economy even more. And you're talking about the battle over immigration in Washington instead of solutions as to how we can deal with those who are here illegally.
Isn't it Rudy Giuliani who stepped on that message that you're talking about?
You know, the media loves to talk about somebody's comment. Okay, they're having a schoolyard spat. Who loves America? I don't doubt that the president loves America, but I do doubt that we're focusing on solving the problems in Washington that we need to. And instead of fighting about stupid things like this or measles vaccines or evolution, let's focus on coming together as we did after September 11th and solving the very real problems facing the American people.
Well,
our government doesn't work.
Well, you know, Governor Ridge, let me take this to you. I hear Governor Pataki blaming the media. In fact, Governor Scott Walker tweeted this morning, "Enough with the media's gotcha game. We started our American revival to talk about big, bold ideas." And I get that. But when a leading Republican, who once ran for president, by the way, and was a serious candidate, says something like the president doesn't love America, is he a divider and not a uniter, as George W. Bush might say?
Well, we certainly know that Rudy is not concerned about how people respond to his sentiments. I, for one, disagree with my friend, and Rudy is a friend. He's a great and accomplished leader. I think there's enormous frustration.
It was a hateful remark. But
I think the point that George is trying to make and I'm trying to make is that he's got this strong opinion. Everybody knows Rudy articulates his opinions that way. He's zealous about that. But we need to get beyond that. He was expressing a frustration in a way that I don't agree with. I don't doubt the president's patriotism. It's not about love of country. It's about leadership or lack of leadership. And the way he articulated it, I don't particularly care for it. I don't think George cares for it. I don't think Darrell cares for it. But it's typical Rudy. But I think the end of the day is...
But
he's always aggressive. He's always up front. I mean, you never walk away from a conversation with Rudy Giuliani questioning how he feels about a particular point of view.
Yeah, but this was a personal insult to the President of the United States.
Yes, and it has been rejected by most of his colleagues and his friends. But at the end of the day, there's enormous frustration with the presidential leadership or lack thereof? How about the flexibility with Putin? They gobbled up more Ukraine. How about we're going to get rid of Assad? Well, he's been able to kill 200,000 of his own citizens and hundreds of thousands left. ISIL's not a JV team. Tehran has more authority and influence in Baghdad than we do. That's what everybody's concerned about. So Rudy articulated it in a very bold, dramatic, in a way that most of us don't agree with, but it's about the frustration with the president.
Well,
not about
Rudy. He kind of hijacked the conversation in a different direction.
He certainly hijacked it, but again, look what we're talking about today on a popular Sunday news program, not about ISIL, not about Iran nuclear negotiations, not about the Ukraine being gobbled up by the individual that President Obama said, well, after the election, I'll have more flexibility. We certainly have more flexibility. So I guess these are the things that are concerning a lot of people. And instead of talking about Rudy, and we probably beat that one down pretty good so far, there's a lot of other things we need to be talking about. Well, I think that's what my colleagues are saying.
Let Congressman Issa get his 2 cents in here. Do you have any defense for what the mayor said?
Well, I don't think Rudy's ever going to get the dust from ground zero out of his lungs. He was there during the fall of those towers. So for him to take personally a president whose policies have left Israel hanging, have left our Arab allies not trusting us, have let ISIL, as the governor said, go from being called a JV team as they took on more territory expansively from Algeria to Iraq than, in fact, the size of Texas. So the reality is that Rudy has taken our debate, and I think we should thank him for this part of it, back to national security, to the key element that the president should be focusing on. He needs to call it Islamic terrorism. He can't be looking at everything through the vision that somehow if you treat people better, if we're more democratic, you're not going to have terrorism, and then have his own secretary telling people they have to be vigilant if they go to a mall in Minnesota. The reality is that we are losing the war against Islamic fundamentalists around the world, and it is not about religion, he says, but it is about religion. These people hate us for who we are and who we're not. And if we don't get on board with allies we can find and root out these terrorist organizations, then America will not be safe. They're saying it on this Sunday, and yet at the same time, we have a haphazard, no boots on the ground effort around the globe. And that's just not right. And Rudy cares passionately about America's national security. And one thing to remember about Rudy, he governed a city that was vast majority Democratic. He's not a partisan politician in any real way, but
partisan comments, though.
You know what? When President Obama implied that, actually said that Bush was unpatriotic for his spending in 2008, that was wrong, too. There's plenty of that kind of behavior that goes on. But the policies that Rudy is talking about on the trail are important, and the policies have to be about national security. It's nice to do a war on poverty again, but the reality is we look to our presidents to go around the world and make sure that our friends believe in us and can work with us, and our enemies fear us and know that we are not going to tolerate them.
Let me take this to Governor Pataki, who is... Am I correct thinking about a run for the presidency?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. So when as a potential presidential candidate, we have asked lots of potential presidential candidates this week about Rudy Giuliani's comments. Some of them have disowned them, for example, Jeb Bush. Some of them, like Scott Walker, refused to comment. Yesterday, he told the Washington Post he wasn't sure if the president was a Christian, and then his press secretary had to clean that up a little bit. Don't you think Republican presidential candidates, who are blindsided by this, I admit, but don't you think they have to come out there and say what they believe about what Rudy Giuliani said directly? You need to do that?
I think when you're asked the question, you have to answer it.
So?
Yes, I think what he said was wrong. But I think it was wrong. But what I understand is that Rudy and I saw the horrible consequences of looking the other way because radical Islamic terror was thousands of miles across the world. And we saw the thousands of people, many of whom both of us knew, die that day. And we saw the courage with which Americans and New Yorkers responded, and it's deep in our bloods. And when we look today and we see them have training camps, we see them have recruiting centers, we see them have social media capability, and our own Homeland Security Secretary coming on and saying we have to use extreme caution going to a mall here, and we have very weak leadership from Washington, I can understand how you get very upset about that. I get upset about it as well. We have to be proactive and go after those camps on the ground before they can attack us again here.
All right. I think you sense from my colleagues the enormous frustration we have with this litany of decisions and basically non-decisions that the president has made or miscalculations he's made over the past couple of
years. But there's one thing to have frustration with the president, and there's another thing to demean the president.
Yeah, but Gloria, we you know, if we wanted to get on top of the vice president every time he says something flippant, foolish, or vulgar, we could have this discussion every Sunday.
Well, but let me just say something about that, Congressman Issa. The vice president may very well be clumsy, but these remarks were hateful.
Rudy Giuliani, and I think Marco Rubio said it very well when he said exactly that. Look, we can find somebody who believes strongly something. Rudy Giuliani said he didn't believe. He didn't say the president wasn't. He said he didn't believe. Now, the reality is that I do believe that the president believes strongly in America. I just think he views America differently. I was there when he denounced the U.S. Supreme Court in the halls of Congress during the State of the Union for their decision. Yep. His beliefs should be his policy decisions, and I hope we get back onto it.
Let me,
we have a president who doesn't
Ridge
believe the Supreme Court is supreme.
Let me go to Governor Ridge for a moment on this.
Well, I think, again, to reiterate the point that I made before, I think not just among Republicans, but even some of the polls are showing great concern about the direction the president has taken vis-a-vis the multiple foreign policy challenges that we have. And it has resurrected itself in a lot of challenges to the president. Rudy obviously said something that a lot of us reject. But the notion that Rudy was challenging the president's policy, I think that's at the epicenter of this debate that we should be having, is whether or not there should be boots on the ground, whether or not the flexibility he gave to Vladimir Putin led to the incursion into Ukraine.
Whether this hurts that policy debate, because instead of focusing on the policy debate, and you might blame the media, I just think what he said is so out of bounds.
Well,
it's a distraction. There's no question it's a distraction, because what we want to talk about, need to talk about, is America being safe, our allies realizing that they can count on us again. Look, Bibi Netanyahu is coming to the U.S. House to a joint session because, in fact, he's not being heard by this president at a time in which Tehran is heading toward a nuclear weapon aimed at him. We have some real problems where our allies do not trust us, and our enemies obviously do not fear us. That has to change.
Well, and Governor Pataki, let me say this to you. If you might run for the presidency, in the last presidential election, you had a Republican presidential candidate, Mitt Romney, who was in a private fundraiser and made the now infamous 47% remarks, which really hurt his candidacy. You now have Rudy Giuliani at a private event making some very direct and inflammatory remarks about the President of the United States at a private event. So what can you say to people who might be thinking about...
And Gloria?
Yes.
And Gloria, you have a president whose policies have frustratingly made, in my view, America much more vulnerable to attack than we've been since September 11th.
And that's what we should be discussing.
But why are we talking about a 2012 election?
But what do you say
I don't understand why we're not talking about standing with Egypt, arming the Peshmerga. Your earlier show this morning talked about how the Peshmerga were not getting the arms and the support that they need.
I think
These are the type of policy discussions that we should be having.
And I think we are having them, and I think it's been hijacked. But let me get to my question about you as a potential presidential candidate, which is why should voters who are thinking of voting Republican believe that? People are saying one thing about how they feel privately, to the to fundraisers, to people who want to, you know, throw red meat out to candidate backers, and another thing in public. So what can the Republican Party do to convince voters that, in fact, it wants to broaden itself? It has a real foreign policy message that it wants to deliver, which we've heard from you all this morning, and convince the American public that
Gloria,
it is a party that they should vote for.
Gloria, you may be a little surprised, but the Republican Party has done pretty well of late. We control both houses of Congress, most of the governorships and the state legislators, and you're acting as though the Republican Party is somehow suffering enormously. The individual candidates have to express to the people why they have the vision and the experience to be able to not just run this country, but change this country's
government.
Right,
but to win the White House
because
back.
We have to change Washington. And it comes down to the individual candidate, their vision, experience, and the ideas that they have. And I know we have to change this country is a great country with a very weak government. It's the government in Washington that has to change, not the American people.
No, and what I was talking about was the Republicans becoming a presidential party as opposed to being usually successful.
The Republican Party is doing well.
But more than that,
Gloria, the other point I'd make is it's not just about Republicans. It's about the American people coming together and understanding that we have a common future. The politicians, the media, so many try to point fingers at each other. Let's solve problems. I saw what Americans could do when we stand together in the months and years after September 11th. Right now, it's the politicians who divide us. Let's solve problems, move forward together, and if we do, the best for this country is ahead of us.
And I'm going to just go to former Homeland Security Secretary, first Homeland Security Secretary Ridge, and ask you about, first of all, what you've heard this morning from Jay Johnson, and secondly, about this fight to cut off funding.
Well, first of all, I appreciate Jay's reminder to the general public that law enforcement and the military are very much a tip of the spear, but we do encourage awareness, not only in that mall, but just generally. That's unfortunately the world within which we are going to live, and it may be a permanent condition, particularly this kind of propaganda films getting everyone appropriately excited. But remember, they've done it before. They did it in Kenya in 2013. But this is what's on the minds of mall owners and those who are responsible for people aggregating in large numbers ever since 9/11, so it's not as if we needed that reminder. I happen to have enormous sympathy for Secretary Johnson. I believe President Obama gravely overreached his constitutional authority. I mean, I just find it very, very troubling, not only on the immigration piece, but he's done it many, many times before. But having said that, it's an overreach. It's a grave overreach. At least we have one judge that agrees with us. Having said that, I don't believe that this country has faced the breadth and the depth of challenges, foreign policy challenges, Al-Qaeda, Al-Shabaab, ISIL, gravest we've ever seen. And so to be talking about immigration and using a funding mechanism to really undermine the department. These are great patriots all. They go to work every day trying to make sure America is safer and more secure. So what I would recommend to my friends on the Hill is accept the notion that we're going to do this either in the judicial branch or perhaps let's send the president a bill or a series of bills dealing with immigration reform.
And fund Homeland Security.
Exactly.
Separately.
And fund it. This is an inside the Beltway game. Listen, moms and dads are concerned about their job, got to get the kids to school, got to pay my bills.
Right.
The one thing they know, and George Pataki alluded to it, they know we got both chambers. We have the House, we have the Senate. They don't know anything about the 60-vote cloture rule in the Senate of the United States. They will blame
the
Republicans.
Tell those House Republicans, right?
I want my Republicans to give the Secretary a clean funding bill and use the legislative process to engage America around the desperate needs, social, humanitarian, economic, for robust immigration reform.
Thank you, governors, and thank you, Congressman Issa, for being with me this morning for a very spirited conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And we did send a pretty clean bill to the president.
Okay. We're going to have to end it there, Congressman.
Well,
thank you so much.
You and I could probably have it slightly.
Have it in the green room. Thanks so much. And next, how important is language in the fight against terror? Deputy Defense Secretary Paul Wolfowitz on whether Obama is right or wrong in his choice of words, and the former deputy secretary on his new role in advising Jeb Bush.